Welcome to the course, Compiler Design. In this lecture, we are going to discuss about one of the concept related to lexical analysis, that is input buffering. So later we will discuss about output of lexical analysis is called as token. Then how to specify token, specification of tokens. So these two topics we are going to cover in this lecture. In input buffering, we'll discuss about buffer pairs, then sentinels. Then under specification of tokens, we'll discuss about strings and languages, operations on languages, regular expressions, regular definitions, then extension of regular expressions. So all these concepts we will recall from the course, formal language and automata theory. So whatever the concepts we discussed related to fundamental concepts of automata theory, that is strings, languages and their operations, then regular expression, regular definitions, etc. All will be recalled from the course formal language and automata theory. Same concepts will be used for specification of tokens. Now let us move to the first one, input buffering. So this is the one of the concept used in lexical analysis for token specification only. So sometimes lexical analyzer needs to look ahead some symbols to decide about the token to return. So the lexical analyzer required to look ahead some advanced symbols which are used to decide about which token to return. For example, in C language, we need to look after the symbols minus, equal, or less than. That means look after these symbols to decide what token to return after these symbols. In another language, Fortran, the statement will be like this: do 5i equal to 1.25. So this is the use of look ahead actually. So here we need to introduce a two buffer scheme to handle large look ahead safely, smoothly. So a two buffer scheme is considered here in input buffering. So the first one, what it contains, buffer pairs. So this is the first approach used in input buffering, which is called as buffer pairs. Because of the amount of time taken to process characters and the large number of characters that must be processed during the compilation of a large source program. The compilation is nothing but a static time. So in this case, specialized buffering techniques have been developed to reduce the amount of overhead required to process a single input character. The main intention of introducing these buffering techniques are to reduce the amount of overhead required to process a single input character. An important scheme involves two buffers that are alternately reloaded as suggested in the following figure. The following figure shows using a pair of input buffers, what it contains. One is lexem begin, another one is forward. So here one of the input E equal to MC square, then end with a special file which is not part of source program, that is end of file, like end marker in any automaton. So here this is the source program E, then one space is given before and after the operator, then E equal to then M into C exponent 2. So that is E equal to MC square. So this is one of the example of using a pair of input buffers. So by using the two methods, lexem begin and forward. Now we'll see one by one what is the use of these methods. So here each buffer is of the same size n, where n is the usually size of a disk block, for example 4096 bytes as usual. Using one system read command, we can read n characters into a buffer rather than using one system call per character. Using one system read command, we can read n characters into a buffer rather than using one system called per character. If fewer than n characters remain in the input file, then a special character represented by EOF, that is end of file, marks the end of the source file. Like in finite automata, input tape, whenever the end markers are included, means which denotes the tape length is of finite, like that. Same in the buffer also, we'll use EOF character, that is end of file character. So marks the end of the source file and is different from any possible character of the source program, that is EOF character. So now here, in this you can observe, here we use two commands or two pointers. One is lexem begin and forward are used. So what are uses of these two actually? The two pointers to the input are maintained. One is lexem begin, another one is forward. So the pointer lexem begin marks the beginning of the current lexem, marks the beginning of the current lexem, whose extent we are attempting to determine. So the pointer lexem begin marks the beginning of the current lexem, whereas the pointer forward scans ahead, that means forward, until a pattern match is formed. These are all the uses of the two input pointers used in input buffer, which are lexem begin and forward. So then the second approach in input buffering is used, is called as sentinels. So when this will be used, what is actually this one? If we use the scheme of buffer pairs as described above, we must check each time we advance forward. Forward means to move ahead, so that we have not moved off one of the buffers. If we do, then we must also reload the other buffer. Thus, for each character read, we make two possible tests. One is for the end of the buffer. Another one is to determine what character is read. That is, the latter may be a multi-way branch. So these two tests are performed to read each and every character. So we can combine the buffer end test with the test for the current character when this will be done. If we extend each buffer to hold a sentinel character at the end. The sentinel is nothing but which is a special character. Special character that cannot be part of the source program. Like in finite automata input tape, the end markers not part of input alphabet. Those are all special characters. Like sentinel also same, is a special character that can't be part of the source program. And the natural choice is the character EOF, end of file. Now EOF is one of the special character which is called a sentinel character. Then the following figure shows the same arrangements as in figure one, but what is the difference here? With additionally, sentinels are added, that means end of files are added. Here note that end of file retains its use as a marker for end of the entire input. Any end of file that appears other than at the end of a buffer means that the input is at end. So now here you can see this arrangement is same as our previous figure. Here additionally, the two sentinels are used, that is here, end of file, here one sentinel, then here one sentinel, then at the end also one sentinel. Here equal to E equal to M into, then here one end of file sentinel is used, then C power two, then again end is used. Then at the end of the buffering, by default, also one sentinel is there. The two pointers remain same, lexem begin and forward. So this is the arrangement of input buffering by adding additionally sentinels. So here sentinels at the end of each buffer. So this figure shows. So then let us see one example algorithm for advancing forward pointer. The following code summarizes the algorithm for advancing forward. So here by using switch case, switch pointer forward plus plus, then within this switch case. Here we have to use case as end of file. Here the condition, if forward is at end of first buffer, then reload second buffer, then forward equal to beginning of second buffer. Then else if forward is at end of second buffer, then reload the first buffer, then forward equal to beginning of the first buffer, opposite to previous case. Else, so here when this will be used, end of file within a buffer marks the end of input at that time. At that time, it terminates lexical analysis, then breaks. Then it breaks. Then cases for other characters. So this is one sample code summarizes the algorithm for advancing the forward pointer. So this is one sample example. Look ahead code with sentinels. Sentinels are end of file. So that's all about input buffer. Now we'll move to our next concept, specification of tokens. So this is very important in lexical analysis for specifying tokens. In theory of compilation, regular expressions, we know the concept of regular expressions in finite automata, are used to formalize the specification of tokens. Regular expressions are means for specifying regular languages. For example, letter followed by letter or digit. R means this is nothing but plus with the whole closure, that is star closure, which includes null. So this is one of the regular expression for identifier. Each regular expression is a pattern specifying the form of string. So what each regular expression describes? A pattern specifying the form of strings. So now, first, before starting the definition of regular expression, okay, the fundamental definitions related to automata theory, you can recall like symbol, alphabet, then string or word, then string operations, then language operations. So all these concepts we studied in the formal language and automata theory under first concept, the fundamental concepts of automata theory or theory of computation. We will review the same concepts once again. First, how to define a symbol? A symbol is an abstract entity that we shall not define formally. Examples, the frequently used symbols are letters. You can use uppercase letters A to Z or lowercase letters small a to small z. Then digits 0 to 9, then some special characters. These are all frequently used symbols. Then next definition is alphabet. So an alphabet is non-empty finite set of symbols. It is denoted by the symbol sigma. Example, sigma equal to 0, 1 is the binary alphabet which consisting of digits 0, 1. Then another example, ASCII is an important example of an alphabet. It is used in many software systems. Then another example, Unicode, which includes approximately, here you can see, 1 lakh characters from alphabets around the world is another important example of an alphabet, Unicode. Then another example, sigma equal to A, B, C, which consisting of lowercase letters, is an alphabet consisting of letters A, B, and C. These are some of the examples of alphabet. Then coming to string or word. A string or word is defined as a finite sequence of symbols over an alphabet sigma. Then in language theory, the term sentence or word are often used as synonyms for string. Let us see examples of strings. First, let us take an alphabet sigma equal to A, B. Then the possible strings are formed. String is denoted by generally W equal to. The possible strings are with AB alphabets. First, with individual characters A, B, then two combinations, maybe repetitions also allowed, that is AA, AB, BA, BB. Then three combinations, even by including repetitions, AAA, AAB, ABA, BAA, BBB, and so on. Like that, infinite strings are generated from this alphabet sigma equal to A, B. Then another example, sigma equal to 0, 1. Here two digits are there. So with these two digits, what are the possible strings are generated? Same as above A comma B. Now here you can use 0 comma 1. First 0 1 0 0 0 1 1 0 1 1 triple 0 0 0 1 0 1 0 1 double 0 triple 1 and so on. Like that infinite strings are generated from the alphabet 0 comma 1. Then these are some of the examples. Now see some of the operations on strings. As we already discussed in automata theory, some of them we will review here. The length of a string, let us say S, usually written as mod S. How to define length of the string is the number of occurrences of symbols in S or the number of symbols composing the string is called as the length of the string, which is denoted by mod of that string name. For example, here you can take banana is a string. So what is its length here? Irrespective of repetitions of the characters from left to right, you can count the number of characters occurred, including repetitions also. Here, banana, here you can see this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Total, here you can see 6 characters are there. So the length of this string banana is 6 now. Then empty string. Empty string is denoted by epsilon or sometimes lambda. Is the string of length 0. This we know. Then if X and Y are strings, then the concatenation of X and Y denoted by first string followed by second string without space. That is written as XY. If the string formed by appending Y to X, adding Y to X in the right hand side. For example, if X equal to dog and Y equal to house, then the concatenation of X and Y is written as a first string followed by second string without space. That is dog house. Then empty string is the identity under concatenation. So that is for any string S, you can concatenate with empty string. That is epsilon S equal to S epsilon. Then you will get the original string only. Concatenation of a string with empty string, there is no change. You will get the original string only. These are only some of the operations of strings. Then some of the terms for parts of strings, like this also we covered in the concept of automata theory. So terms for parts of the strings, the following string related terms are commonly used. The first one is a prefix. The second one is a suffix. So how to define a prefix of a string? Yes, is any string obtained by removing zero or more symbols from the end of the string? Yes. For example, so removing zero or more symbols from the end of the string? Yes. So now banana is the original string. Now B-A-N. See, end A-N-A is removed. Then another one. B-A-N-A-N-A, the given string itself also, and epsilon. Now you can see B-A-N, B-A-N-A-N-A-N, and epsilon are prefixes of banana. Similarly, a suffix. Suffix means at the starting, you can remove zero or more symbols. A suffix of a string S is any string obtained by removing zero or more symbols from the beginning of S. For example, here, banana BA is removed, then NANA, then the original string itself, BANANA, and epsilon are suffixes of banana. So there we discussed the example W equal to XYZ. Now here, prefixes are, what are the prefixes? Including epsilon, X, then XY, XYZ. So at the end, removing some of the symbol zero or more. Similarly, suffixes. Suffixes means at the beginning you can remove. So here epsilon, then here you can take Z, then YZ, then XYZ. These are all suffixes. Same, here we have taken other string, banana. So these are all the prefixes and suffixes. So then a substring. A substring of a string S is obtained by deleting any prefix and any suffix from S. For instance, so B-A-N-A-N-A-N-A, banana, then N-A-N. So N-A-N, here you can see starting B-A is prefixes are removed, then A suffix is also removed. Here you can see BA, NA, NA. Here prefix and suffixes are removed. Then including null also, or substrings of banana. That means you can start at any position. You can take some conjugative characters in the given original string. Those are all called as substrings of the string. Then proper prefixes and suffixes and substrings. So proper prefix or proper suffix or substrings are the prefixes and suffixes and substrings except the original string itself. So the proper prefixes, suffixes and substrings of a string, yes, are those prefixes, suffixes and substrings respectively of S that are not epsilon or not equal to S itself. So here you can see, for example, in the prefixes, excluding this one, these are all called as proper prefixes. Proper prefixes. Similarly, excluding the given string itself, epsilon Z Y Z are proper suffixes. Even proper substring also same, except the original string itself. These are some of the terms which are related to strings. So then coming to the next concept, language. So how to define a language? A language is set of strings of symbols from some one alphabet sigma. A language L is subset of sigma closure. Then an empty set pi and the set consisting of empty string is written as the null within the set brackets are the languages, and these two are distinct. Then see, let us see some of the operations on languages. First, you can take union. Union of two languages L1 and L2 are defined as L1 union L2 equal to S such that S is in L1 or S is in L2. Why? Because this is union. Then concatenation of two languages L1 and L2 is denoted as L1, L2. Let us say ST, where S is in L1, the first language, then T is in L2. Then the both strings in N1 and L2 are combined without any space. Then clean closure. So clean closure is also called as star closure, which is denoted with asterisk. L closure, by default, star closure can be written as star closure equal to union, I equal to 0 to infinite L power I. Nothing but here you can substitute L power 0, union L power 1, union L power 2, union and so on, infinite. Similarly, positive closure, this is denoted by the symbol plus, denoted as L power plus equal to union, I equal to 1 to infinite L power I. Here, I start with 1, which is called as positive closure here. Null is excluded, whereas star closure, we start with 0, that is L power 0, which includes null also. Here, this is nothing but L power 1 union, L power 2 union, L power 2, L power 3, and so on. So here, null is excluded, here null is included. That is the difference between star closure and positive closure. These are all some of the operations on languages. Now, let us see some of the examples. Let L be the set of letters with a combination of uppercase letters, capital A to Z, and lowercase letters, small a to Z. And let capital D be the set of digits 0 to 9. So now here two sets are used, L and D. Now you can see L union D, that is union, is the set of letters and digits. Strictly speaking, the language with 62 strings of length 1, each of which strings is either one letter or one digit, are formed with this. Then LD is the concatenation. Is the set of 520 strings of length 2, each consisting of one letter followed by one digit, are formed. Then L power 5 is the set of all 5 letter strings. That means with length 5. Then L power star, that is positive closure, is the set of all strings of letters including null, the empty string. Then another example, L concatenation with L union D whole closure is the set of all strings of letters and digits beginning with a letter. Here it must start with a letter followed by letter or digit with zero or more combination. Then D power plus, which is positive closure, is the set of all strings of one or more digits. Zero is not allowed. That is, null is not allowed here. These are all the some of the examples of operations on languages. So then coming to regular expressions. So what is regular expression? We know the language accepted by finite automata can be easily described by simple expressions called as regular expressions. Regular expressions are useful for representing certain sets of strings in an algebraic fashion. These describe the languages which are accepted by finite automata. Now, recall the definition of regular expression. We have the recursive definition of regular expression. A recursive definition of regular expression over an alphabet sigma is defined as follows. Any terminal symbol that is small a, that is an element of sigma, that is a belongs to sigma, then an empty set pi, and then empty string, that is epsilon or lambda, which are called as regular expression. This is the first rule. The second rule, the union of two regular expressions, say R1 and R2, as written as R1 plus R2, is also a regular expression. Then the concatenation of two regular expressions, R1 and R2, written as R1, R2, is also a regular expression. Then the closure or iteration, which is denoted by asterisk, of a regular expression R, is written as R power star, is also a regular expression. Then if R is a regular expression, then R within parentheses is also a regular expression. Then the regular expressions over an alphabet sigma are precisely those obtained recursively by the applications of the rules 1 to 5, the above rules 1 to 5, by repeating once or several times, whatever the results we obtained, those are all only the regular expression. So this is a recursive definition of regular expression. Let us see some examples. Same examples we discussed in our concept of formal language and automata theory, so during regular expression. So now here, we have a regular set. Then any set that is represented by regular expression is called as the regular set. Then the equivalent regular expression. Regular expression is which is combination of the above six rules only. Now a regular set, also called as a regular language, which is denoted within set bracket. So now here within set bracket, we have 101. So now as for regular expression, we don't have set brackets, but we have concatenation. Simply you have to remove the set brackets, then you will get one string, 101. That is concatenation of 101, which is a regular expression. Then another example, ABBA. Again, a single string, ABBA. So include within set bracket. This is a regular set. Then if you can remove set brackets, then ABBA, concatenation of ABBA, is a regular expression. Then we have 01 comma 10. Two strings are there. Then which are represented in the form of regular set or regular language. You can remove set bracket, then comma is replaced with plus. Then string 1 plus string 2. So this is a regular expression. Then epsilon comma AB, here same. You can remove comma and add plus between epsilon and AB. Then you will get epsilon plus AB is also a regular expression. Similarly, ABA comma A comma B comma BBA. You can remove set brackets and comma is replaced with plus. Then you will get a regular expression. Then null comma 0 comma 00 comma 000 and so on. Here also same. Epsilon comma 0 comma 0 plus 00 plus 000 plus and so on. So if you can simplify this one, you will get this nothing but zero closure. That is R closure, including null. Then 1 comma 11 comma 111 and so on. Here also you will get 1 plus 11 plus 111 plus and so on. So this is nothing but with the simplified version, 1 closure. Then A comma B can be written as A plus B. Then A comma B whole closure can be written as A plus B whole closure. So the regular sets and corresponding regular expression. Then some more examples. So all these examples we already covered in the concept of regular expressions in the subject formal language and automata theory. You can recall those lectures again if you want. So now another example, L1 equal to the set of all strings of zeros and ones ending in 00. So here, every string end with 00. Then set of all zeros and ones combinations can be written as, first you can write down epsilon comma 0 comma 1 comma 00 comma 01 comma 10 comma and so on. This is for, this is nothing but 0 plus 1 whole closure. Then you can concatenate 00 at the right end. So then what you will get, if you can simplify this one, this is nothing but 0 plus 1 closure, then ending with 0, 0. So this is the regular expression satisfying this regular set. Another example, the set of all strings of zeros and ones beginning with 0 and ending with 1. First with 0, 1, all combinations, what you will get? Epsilon 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and so on. So then beginning, you can add 1, 0. Then ending, you can add 1, 1. Then what is the inside value? That is nothing but 0 plus 1 whole closure. Then starting 0, ending 1. So which satisfies the given regular set. So then these are also some of the examples. Now, a language that can be defined by a regular expression is called as a regular set. Any language that can be defined by a regular expression, which is called as a regular set. If two regular expressions, say R and S, denote the same regular set, we say that they are equivalent and written as R equal to S. Two regular expressions, R and S, denote the same regular set. Then we say both are equivalent and can be written as R equivalent S. That is equivalent of two regular sets of regular expressions. Then let us see, identities are algebraic laws of regular expressions. This concept also we discuss. The following are identities are algebraic laws of regular expressions, which are used to simplify regular expression. The first identity, I1 equal to empty set pi plus a regular expression R. You will get the result as regular expression R only. Then concatenation of empty set pi with regular expression R. Then reverse R pi, you will get the empty set pi only. Then if you can concatenate with empty string epsilon with a regular expression R, then reverse R epsilon, you will get R. Epsilon is the identity for concatenation. Then epsilon closure equal to epsilon, then pi closure equal to epsilon. Then R plus R equal to R only. Then R closure, concatenation equal to, you will get one R closure only. Then R closure equal to, then reverse R closure, R equal to, you will get R closure only. Then R closure, whole closure equal to, you will get single R closure only. Then next identity, PQ whole closure P is equivalent to, you can change the brackets, that is association. Then PQP whole closure, both are equal. Then P plus Q whole closure equal to Q closure whole closure. That is equal to P closure plus Q closure whole closure. Any of these are all equal. Identities means left hand side equal to right hand side equal to left hand side. Both ways are satisfied. Then another one, P plus Q concatenation with R equal to the order, first distribution law. This is P R plus Q R in the same order. Then reverse, R concatenation with P plus Q, then same order R P plus R Q. Concatenation distributive. Then another identity, P plus Q equal to Q plus P. That is commutative law. Then P plus Q plus R equal to P plus Q plus R by changing the brackets, associative. Then P concatenation with Q R equal to PQ concatenation with R. Concatenation associative. Then P Q R equal to PQ R. Concatenation associative, same. Changing the order. Then here you can see PQR, PQR. Yeah, this both are same, actually repeated. Then R closure equal to, also can be written as R plus epsilon whole closure, where epsilon is guaranteed in a closure. Then R double closure equal to R closure only, where here closure is idempotent. Then here, in this identities are algebraic laws, we used to P, Q and R, which are regular expressions. These are identities or algebraic laws of regular expressions. So then coming to the next definition, regular definition. This is not a regular expression, regular definition. So for notational convenience, we may wish to give names to certain regular expressions. So earlier we have whatever the regular expression, you can provide a name to each and every regular expression. That is called as regular definition. For notational convenience, we may wish to give names to certain regular expressions and use those names in subsequent expressions as if the names were themselves symbols. For example, here sigma is an alphabet of the basic symbols. Then a regular definition is a sequence of definitions of the form. here definition 1 d1 equal to regular expression 1, then definition 2 equal to regular expression 2, and so on. Definition n equal to regular expression n, where r1 r2 and so on rn are the regular expressions, whereas d1 d2 and so on dn are the regular definitions. That means we have to providing names to the regular expressions. So r1 is named as d1, r2 is named as d2, and so on rn is named as dn. These are called as regular definitions, where each di is a new symbol, not in sigma, and not the same as any other definitions. And each ri is a regular expression over the alphabet sigma union d1 d2 and so on di minus 1. So where these are not in sigma, but ris are regular expressions over alphabet includes definitions also. These are all the regular definitions. Let us see some examples. For example, C identifiers. In C language, identifiers are strings of letters, digits, and underscores. Here is a regular definition of the language of C identifiers as given below. We shall conventionally use italics for the symbols defined in a regular definition. Here you can see letter underscore equal to A, R, B, and so on, Z, all uppercase letters. Then lowercase letters, small a or small b, and so on, small z. Then followed by year end with underscore. Then digit equal to 0, 1, 2, 9. Then ID equal to letter underscore or digit whole closure. Now we can see letter underscore is one of the definition of the regular expression, D1. Then digit is the another definition of the regular expression for digits. Then ID is the another definition of regular expression for the identifier. So then another example, unsigned numbers, integer or floating point, are strings such as 5280 or 0.01234, then 6.336e^4 or 1.89e^-4. The regular definitions are digit equal to 0 to 9, then digits is equal to concatenation of digit closure, then optional fraction equal to floating point dot digits or null, then optional exponent equal to e plus or minus or null, then digits or null, then number equal to digits followed by optional fraction followed by optional exponent. Now we can say these are all the regular definitions, d1 d2 d3 d4 d5, but these are all named. Number is the name, optional exponent is the name, optional fraction is the name, then digit is the name, then digits is the name, then digit is also name. So these are all the regular definitions. So then we have some extensions of regular expressions also. Extensions of regular expressions. So since clean, that is asterisk, introduce regular expressions with the basic operators for union, concatenation, and clean closure, which is asterisk. In the 1950s, many extensions have been added to regular expressions to enhance their ability to specify string pattern. That is called as extension of regular expression. So one or more instances, the first case, that is R power plus, that is R positive closure. The unary comma postfix operator plus represents the positive closure of a regular expression and its language. That is, if R is a regular expression, then R power plus denotes the language L of R power plus. Then the operator plus has the same precedence and associativity as the operator asterisk. But the only difference, it won't allows null. Then two useful algebraic class with combination of R positive closure. R closure equal to R positive closure or epsilon. And R positive closure equal to R R closure is equal to R closure R. Relate the clean closure and positive closure. These are some of the algebraic laws related to this extension of regular expression R positive closure. Then second extension, which is called as 0 R one instance, simply denoted by R. the unary postfix operator using question mark means 0 or 1 occurrence, that is R question mark is equivalent to R or null, or put another way, L of R question mark equal to L of R union null. This is the meaning of this one. The question mark operator has the same precedence and associated as asterisk and plus. Then the third extension example is character classes. Within square brackets, you can represent characters. Let us say ABC. A regular expression A1 or A2 and so on AN, where AIs or each symbols of the alphabet can be replaced by the shorthand within square bracket. So A1, A2 and so on AN. For example, here let us consider some of the examples. Letter underscore equal to within square bracket A to Z, that is starting uppercase letter A, ending with Z, then followed by lowercase letter A to lowercase letter Z, then end with underscore. So simply you can represent in character classes within square bracket. Then digit, simply 0 to 9, instead of writing 0, 1, and so on. Starting value, ending value. Range within square bracket. Then ID equal to letter, underscore, or digit, whole closure. So these are all the some of the examples of extensions of regular expressions. So now let us come to summary of this lecture, what we covered. First, we covered input buffering as a two approaches. We used buffer pairs and sentinels. Sentinels is nothing but end of file or added. Then buffer pair uses two pointers, that is exim begin and forward. Then later we discussed about the specification of tokens. Under these specifications, strings and languages, operations and languages, regular expressions, regular definitions, then extensions of regular expressions. So the related reference to this lecture in AHO second edition, the sections 3.2 and 3.3. So now I stop here. Next lecture, we'll come up with our next concept, that is the recognition of tokens.